far superior to the Americans.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا قال إنني من المسلمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. You're most welcome to ask any questions on Islam and comparative religion. So brothers and sisters, if you have any questions, they're most welcome. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ladies who are menstruating, they're not able to have all the fast in the month of Ramzan, so they have to kala. But for example, I started my fast a day earlier than Bombay because I started from Madras. So can that be considered for one extra fast can be calculated in the kala? Or I know a friend who started from here and went to a part of Tamil Nadu where there is conflicting of two fasts. They did only 28 and celebrated Eid. So does he has to do two more kalas or can you explain about that?
Sister, the fast that you start in the month of Ramadan, whichever part of the world you're in, you start along with the Jama of that area. So if you're in Saudi Arabia, Ramadan starts from there, you can start from there. When it comes here, you end here. But if it becomes more than the required, for example, previously, normally 2 days earlier they used to start. If I'm in Saudi Arabia, I start 2 days earlier and then come to Bombay. And then if I end with Bombay, then in the end I fast 32. So then the option is given to me, they cannot be more than 30 days, either 29 or 30 days. So if it comes to more than 30, the last two fasts of Bombay I can either keep or I can keep as nafil extra fast. That cannot be fard fast. Similarly, if you start in Bombay and then end in Saudi, so I start 2 days late and it's too fast, I'm keeping less, 28 days. So that I have to make qaza after Ramadan. So what you have missed, you have to, but you can't make qaza before. You can't make qaza before. So I haven't heard of making qaza before. So that's not right. So if you have missed the fast during the menstruation, you have to keep it after Ramadan, you can't give it before. The before fast, optional fast, unless it is part and parcel. If you go back to Saudi Arabia before Ramadan ends, so that becomes part of the fard roza you have kept, but you can't do qada before. But if suppose there's a problem, like the moon has been sighted and you start in Saudi, maybe one day earlier, and you come here, and suppose the moon, they decide, okay fine, we start Ramadan one day late. And Ramadan of that time was only 28 days. So the Muslims of Bombay, after Eid is over, they have to fast one day extra. Now because I started one day earlier being in Saudi Arabia, I need not keep that qada roza. Is it clear? Because I started one day earlier. But you cannot say that I am going to fast the advanced fast and count it as a qada. That cannot be acted as a qada. That's what you started. But one thing is there, sister. Now because you started in Saudi Arabia one day earlier, that is part of your Ramadan. So if there are 30 days, in Saudi Arabia 30 days, and in Bombay 30 days, and if you start one day earlier, and then in Bombay if you miss 5 days, so actually the last one day that you are keeping in Bombay is extra roda. So that can be counted as a qaza roda. Do you understand? Means you start suppose 2 days early in Saudi Arabia, and 30 days was the month of Ramadan in Saudi Arabia. You come here and you continue, and in between you miss about 6 fasts because of your cycles. But you are supposed to end on 30. Now two options you have got. The last two fasts of Bombay don't keep. Or you keep those two fasts as qaza. So that can be acted as qaza. Is it clear? So finally if the Bombayites have maintained 30 days. But if there it is 30 days, here 29, so at least 30 you have to keep. So 30 you can keep. If it's more than 30, then that can be counted in the extra fast and can be included. That you have to do qaza less. So that's not an early qaza. You started on time with Saudi Arabia. But if you say that being in Bombay, if I start 2 days earlier, that cannot be counted as qada. Because if you're in Saudi Arabia and you start along with the Jama there, that can be counted as a fard roza. But the last two rozas that you keep, if it is more than 30, that can be counted as excess roza. And that can be counted in the qada roza. Hope that answers the question, sister.
We have 28, 29.
Yes, in a lunar month, Islamic month, it can't be 28 days. Either 29 or 30. So if it's 28 days, you come to know that we started one day late. You have to keep. But if we see the moon, like this is moon. We say, oh, the moon was a bit big. It should have been, it is actually a second day moon. It should have been 30 days. We kept 29. So that's nothing of qada for that. If you keep 29, even if you come to know it started one day late, then nothing is no requirement of qada. Because we didn't see the moon. To start Ramadan, you have to see the moon. But then we realize at the end of the month, the 28 days we see the new moon, it can't be possible. So it's a confirmed fact that we start one day late, then we have to keep qada. You understand? Because there's a hadith of the Prophet, the one the Sahaba, Sahib the Ramadan, he saw that, okay, this is the moon of the second day. The Prophet said, don't think like that. Maybe Allah made it much more. You can say, fatter. So you don't have that doubt in your heart that we start Ramadan late. You think we start on time, maybe Allah made it bigger. And one more thing, that if you miss the new moon, just by a few minutes, the next day moon will look like a 2 days moon. I mean, that's but logic. When the new moon came, but because of the sun was present, you could not see the new moon. And you can't see it. And scientifically, with the telescope also you can't see. So if you just miss it by a couple of minutes, the next day moon will be like a 2 days moon. So people who think, oh, no, this is a 2 days moon, we start one day late, all these are their own hypothesis, they don't know science very well. So if you miss the new moon, even by a few minutes, you cannot see it. The next day moon will be a 2 days moon. So all these are hypotheses. Hope that's the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This could be a fake question, but I require some scientific explanation for this. In a lot of developing towns, there's a shortage of water. So they have come up, the local authorities, they have come up with STPs. Water comes out of it, they say it is pure. Except drinking, you can use it for taking bath and washing clothes. So just wanted to know, is it a permissible Islamic way, because the water is treated from the, you know, impure water? It is allowed?
Well, that's a question that, because like the water, they take out from the sewage water and they treat it in a way that it becomes pure for everything except drinking. Now, you should realize that there are certain requirements for drinking water about the contents and mineral content, etc. So the water they take out from tube well, even there they say it is not safe for drinking. For washing clothes, bath, no problem. So that is because for drinking it's not pure. But otherwise, the Islamic aspect is that when you put dirt in the ocean doesn't become dirty, that water becomes clear. So similarly, if they make a treatment such a way that the impurities are removed, then it becomes pure, no problem. I'm just giving a simple example. Say sewage water. Fine? It is dirty. It evaporates. It turns into cloud. The cloud water coming down is pure or not? So that is Allah's purification system, evaporation, and getting down. You take it, it's 100% pure even for drinking. Unless there are some problems in the pollution, etc. Now they are adopting a system and purifying it. It should be pure. Having a bath, doing wudu, no problem. So Islamically, there is no problem at all. Hope that answers the question. Allah purifies by evaporation. So you know the dirt and feces, etc. in the muck and slum area, and it's evaporating, it becomes clear. So they also do a somewhat similar system with the purified, so no problem at all. Hope that answers the question.
একটি পরিকল্পিত আলোচনা
জন্ম নিয়ন্ত্রণ চিন্তাধারা কতটা ইসলামের সাথে সঙ্গতিশীল
মানবতার কল্যাণের জন্য
তারা নিজ দেশে বলছে সন্তান বাড়াও অপরদিকে মুসলিম দেশগুলিতে জনসংখ্যা কমানো যায় এর পুরস্কার ঘোষণা করছে
উন্নতি সাধনের জন্য
কোরআন হাদিসের জ্ঞান মানুষের যখন থাকে না তখনই মানুষ এই পদক্ষেপ নেয় এটা অনেকগুলো দিক রয়েছে
ডক্টর আব্দুল্লাহ জাহাঙ্গীর আব্দুর রাজ্জাক বিন ইউসুফ শেখ শাহিদুল্লাহ খান মাদানী মুফতি কাজী মোহাম্মদ ইব্রাহিম জাহাঙ্গীর আলম
সর্বশ্রেষ্ঠ চূড়ান্ত ধর্ম ইসলাম
রিজিক দাতা মাতাও নন পিতাও নন
মুসলমানের একটা আস্থা বিশ্বাস গোটা বিশ্বের তিনি রব
আল্লাহ তাআলা মানব জাতিকে সৃষ্টি করেছেন এর মূল ইউনিট হলো পরিবার
বোঝেন জীবনের বার্তা জ্ঞান গর্ভ আলোচনার মঞ্চ প্রতি রবিবার রাত 9:30 আর পুনঃ সম্প্রচার সকাল 8:00 বাংলাদেশে পিস টিভি বাংলায় Marriage or divorce?
What's Islamic
religion? My husband wants to give divorce.
Solution or problem?
Joint family system.
Heaven or hell?
Big fatty Islam have become the norm.
You choose. Beauty. Wealth. Family status. Virtue. Decide what you want. Decide your choice. Be sad or be happy. It's your choice. Join Dr. Zakir Naik. Dekhun, Ardhangini Natitangini. Prati Rabibar, Raat 7:30 Aap Puno Shamprachar. Shakal 9:30 Bangladeshe. Peace TV Banglaaye.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My one Hindu brother was asking me about the Islamic system of marriage. Means a law of four marriages. How can I give him a satisfactory answer? And how can we prove that is the most correct and most suitable?
Brother asked a very common question, that how can I convince a non-Muslim that Islam gives permission to have more than one wife, four wives, how can I convince him? How can I prove that this is the best? Nowhere does Islam say that four marriages is the best, or Islam gives permission. In fact, Quran is the only religious scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one. You read all the other scriptures, whether you read the Mahabharata, Ramayana, Bhagavad Gita, Bible, no religious scripture on the face of the earth says marry only one except the Quran. If you read the Hindu scriptures, Ramayana, the father of Ram, King Dashrath, he had three wives. Krishna, how many wives he had? 4, 10, 20, 1000, 16,108 wives. So Krishna had 16,108 wives, so why can't be Muslim, I have at least 4. So what is the problem? If you read the Christian scriptures, if you read the Bible, Solomon had 700 wives. Abraham in the Bible had 3 wives. So in Hinduism, Christianity, Judaism, you can marry as many wives as you wish. 4, 5, 10,000, 10,000, no upper limit. It is later on the Christian church which put a ban and said that the Christian should not marry more than one. It is the Jewish rabbi, Benjamin Yehuda, he passed the synod that the Jews should not marry more than one wife. Otherwise, in 1950, in the Jewish community, in the Sephardic communities where Jews live with Muslims, there the Jews had more than one wife. It is later on when the synod was passed that they stopped it. Even Hindus, according to the scriptures, they can marry as many as they wish. It is the Indian Penal Code in 1954 which passed a law called Hindu Marriage Act that a Hindu cannot marry more than one wife. It is the Indian government, but the Hindu scriptures give you permission, you can marry as many as you wish. And if you read the census of the status of women in Islam, on page number 66 and 67, it says that the polygamous marriages, there in a span of 10 years between 1951 to 1961, the Muslims had 4.31. 4.31% of the Muslims, they did polygamous marriages, they made more than one. The Hindus was 5.06. The Hindus did more polygamous marriages as compared to the Muslims in a span of 10 years between 1951 to 1961. So if you read the Quran, as I mentioned, Quran is the only religious book which says marry only one. If you read the Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, it says, marry women of a choice in twos, threes or fours, but if you can't do justice, marry only one. So this statement, marry only one, is only given in the Quran and no other religious scripture. But the Quran also says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 129, that it is difficult to do justice between your wives, but don't turn away from them altogether. So you can marry more than one wife on the condition that you can do justice between them. So marrying more than one wife is not farz in Islam. It is optional. It's not compulsory. It's optional. If you marry, no problem. But if you marry, you should do justice. Now let us analyze the various logical and scientific reasons that why Islam gives permission for certain men to have more than one wife. If you analyze, by nature, male and female are born in equal proportion. But if you ask any pediatrician, any doctor, who is a children's doctor, he will tell you that there are more deaths among the male children as compared to female children. Because the female child can fight the germs and diseases much better than the male child. So in the pediatric age itself, there are more females as compared to males. As life goes on, there are more male dying as compared to females due to cigarette smoking, due to alcoholism, due to war. So today in the world, there are more females as compared to males. Except in the third world country like India and China, etc., where the female population is less than the male population because of female infanticide. In India, according to Emily Beckerin, a British reporter from BBC, she says that every year more than 1 million fetuses are being aborted after they identified that they are females. So if you stop this evil practice of females, there are more females as compared to males. In New York alone, there are 1 million females more than males. In USA alone, there are 7.8 million females more than males. In Germany alone, there are 5 million females more than males. In UK alone, there are 4 million females more than males. In Russia alone, there are 9 million females more than males. And Allah alone knows how many millions of females are more than the males throughout the world. So if I agree with your friend or the non-Muslim that one man should only marry one woman, and suppose the market in America is saturated, that every man has found a woman for himself, your sister or my sister happens in America, and if she has not found a life partner, the only option for her is that she either marries a man who already has a wife, or she becomes public property. People say, public property is such a harsh word. It is the most sophisticated word I can say. There's no two options. Either you marry a man who already has a wife or become public property. So Islam has permitted polygamy, certain men to have more than one wife, to protect the modesty of the women. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I was quoting verses of Yajurveda to my friend, which talks about Shambhuti, Ashambhuti. And he was telling that the meaning of Ashambhuti is not natural elements, it is nature things. So how can I prove him the meaning of Shambhuti and Ashambhuti is that only, which refers in the Veda?
The brother asked a question that when he was quoting one of the quotations which I gave in my talk of Yajurveda, chapter number 40, verse number 9, and that Vishanti, Ya Ashambhuti Upaste. That they are entering darkness, those who worship the Asambhuti. Asambhuti are the natural things. So he is saying, how can you prove Asambhuti is natural and Sambhuti is not natural, is created things? You can go to a dictionary. Suppose if I say that this word means this, fundamentalist, me the person who strictly adheres to the doctrine, disagrees, you go to a dictionary. I show him the Oxford dictionary and he is satisfied. You can go to a Sanskrit dictionary. We have got concordance in a library. We have got Sanskrit dictionaries also. If he knows, he can check up. Tell him. That's what I mentioned in a dictionary. Show him a dictionary, yeah, Sanskrit to English also, Sanskrit to Hindi also, and that will prove the point. Hope that answers the question.
He is claiming that he has read Sanskrit for 2 years.
You ask him, what does it mean? You ask him, what does it mean then? If it doesn't mean natural or uncreated, what does it mean? You ask him. And tell him to give his proof, na? Kulhatu pranakum in kutum sadikin. Produce a proof if you are truthful. That is the translation given in their scriptures. You take a translation by Ralph Giffith, Devi Chand, all these are Hindus and non-Hindu scholars have translated it. They translate like that. If you say it is not like that, you prove it. Not one. We have got 5-6 translations. And all 5-6 say somewhat similar. The choice of words may be different. You have to tell him when 5-6 translations are saying it means natural things, it means not created. Now you come and say something else. Who's right? And these people are PhDs and scholars in Sanskrit. Easy. Give them proof, take a Xerox copy of the Veda, the translation, give it to them. Any sisters have any questions?
Is it that itikaf should be done only in the mosque or can the women do it in their homes?
According to the hadith, the Sahih hadith, the scholars, they're divided. But the Salaf scholars, those scholars who follow strictly Quran hadith, they say since we don't find any hadith, we say the woman did in the house. But if I find various hadith of the wives of the Prophet doing in the mosque, they say the itikaf should only be done in the mosque. There are some scholars, especially some Indian scholars, who say that itikaf can also be done in the house, but there is no hadith which gives evidence for that. Therefore, the view of the scholars which believe more in the Quran than the Sahih hadith, they say the itikaf should only be done in the mosque. But unfortunately, it's a pity that I don't know of any mosque in Bombay which permits women to do itikaf. They may be Allahu Alam. I know there are several mosques. We do allow women to offer salah in the Taraweeh. They have for Taraweeh, but they don't have for Jummah salah. It is weird. See, Taraweeh is not a fard. Jummah salah is a fard. I know they give the argument that because the mosques are so less and the men, where will they go to pray? So it is weird. More important should be Jummah salah, which is again not fard for the women to come, but it's more important than Taraweeh. So we should have this movement of following Quran and Sahih Hadith. We should have mosques which allow salah for every day. 5 times salah they should be allowed, whether they come or they don't come. I don't know of any mosque, at least in Bombay. I know of mosques which allow in Ramadan, like Jummah Masjid allows. There is the Ahle Hadith Bengali Masjid that allow in Jummah. Alhamdulillah, I was shocked, I came to know. But only 20 women come. That also because close to Ramadan. Why? We should encourage this, that they should have 5 times salah whether they come or they don't come. And if a woman wants to do itikaf, I don't know of any mosque. Wallah, I don't know in Bombay. Maybe Allahu Alam. First I thought that there were places. But now when I inquired the 3-4 places we do allow women for Taraweeh, I came to know they don't have any place for itikaf for women. Why? So we should see to it that we should educate these people who are running these mosques and tell them there should be place for women also to have itikaf. There should be place for women because see when we go out, suppose we go for some work outside, and the time for salah is there, we immediately go to any mosque. What about the women? Where will they go? Where will they go? So don't women go out for work? For shopping or whatever it is? I don't know of any mosque, at least in Bombay. They may be, Allahu Alam, I'm not saying they aren't, but I don't know of any, which has 5 times facility for offering salah for the women. You should have a separate place. Let it be small. Let there be at least 10 or 20. So there are some mosques which have for Juma only. But I don't know if any mosque can. During Ramadan, I know the Jama Masjid has. But we should have places where women are allowed in the mosque for 5 times Salah, whenever they require. And they should even have place for itikaf. Inshallah, when Allah gives hidayah to the trustees of the mosque, they see to that least they have a small place, separate facility for the women, inshallah, sister. But doing itikaf, if it's done, itikaf means leaving aside, going to the mosque. Itikaf is normally done only in the mosque, sister. Hope that answers the question. وآخر الدعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين
يا رب إنك أنت السلام